Hey there, and welcome to Play Noggin. I'm Julian, your brain's player too. I grew up watching some pretty terrifying horror movies, and when I say grew up, I mean I was probably too young to be watching Nightmare on Elm Street 2 at 8 years old, Mom. So I'm pretty well-versed in horror. At the same time, I can totally understand why some people can't stomach it, and if you're one of those, this video might not be for you. For a lot of people, myself included, watching horror movies or playing horror games provides an exciting thrill. For others, the tension is uncomfortable, and some of the, shall we say, more grotesque imagery sticks around in the old noggin longer and more vividly than we'd like. Good news for those of us who do enjoy horror, though, we're not psychopaths. Probably. Some researchers believe people who enjoy a good dose of horror use it as a form of catharsis, pushing out all those pent-up negative emotions. But enough about that. What I'm trying to say is, I dig horror games, and Resident Evil 7 is a fantastic horror game. It drops the gun-blazing action from previous entries for more of a Hills Have Eyes slash Deliverance sort of vibe. You're wandering around a creepy plantation mansion owned by some residents who, spoiler alert, are evil. Try as you might, though, you just can't seem to kill these guys. Every time you shoot them, stab them, or get in a protracted chainsaw fight, they simply regenerate, and they're back to chasing you in no time. So, what's up with that? Obviously, it's a video game, so I'm happy to suspend disbelief and blast away a crazy zombie wife until I'm out of ammo, but how far away from reality is the medical technology in this game? I'll admit, I hadn't given a lot of thought to the potential reality of regenerative medicine while I was playing the game because other things were a little more pressing. I knew work was being done, but I hadn't checked in to see when I would be able to regrow my appendix. I miss you, little guy. And I knew certain animals have the ability to regrow limbs, like the Lynchia levingata starfish, for example. But for us, if a hand gets cut off and you don't save it to reattach it, well, who has one thumb and is out of luck? This guy. Since our dumb bodies won't do it on their own, we've had to use our smart brains to figure out how to make it happen. There are several ways this science is being approached, from stimulating adult stem cells in order to encourage organ growth, to artificially creating organs and tissues to be transplanted, eliminating the need for donors. That's good news for our hero Ethan Winters, because the Baker family doesn't seem too willing to part with their own organs, though they do serve up a mean liver and onions, or whatever, whoever that is. One major component of regenerative medicine is called tissue engineering. That's the process of combining cells, biologically active molecules, and what are called scaffolds, the material upon which the tissue is grown, to turn them into active, living tissue. It's very Dr. Frankenstein. When growing tissues, scientists create scaffolds out of a variety of material. It could be protein, it could be plastic. Cells are introduced to the scaffolds, and hopefully, tissues will begin to grow. Scientists have managed to grow artificial skin and cartilage successfully with this technique, though we have only seen limited success in using it with actual patients. Regenerative medicine combines tissue engineering with our body's own propensity to self-heal. Our cells want to be fruitful and multiply, and our bodies want to heal themselves. Regenerative medicine helps them do that in ways nature just won't allow. The idea of these scaffolds was borrowed from nature. When cells reproduce, they typically create their own scaffold, called an extracellular matrix, to grow on. But the matrix doesn't just keep your cells from collapsing into a mushy pile. It also functions as a post office, delivering messages in a timely manner from the environment around it. The information given to the cell via its extracellular matrix plays a big part in determining what happens to the cell. Scientists study how different cells respond to different signals, and are able to influence cells to do things they wouldn't normally do, such as repair damaged tissue or even grow completely new ones. Some of the most exciting research on regenerative medicine is being done with stem cells. Stem cells are a particularly special type of cell that are sort of like a blank slate. They start out undifferentiated, and are able to differentiate into specialized cell types like muscle, bone, skin, etc. You can get them from embryos that are 4 or 5 days old, and those are called, as you might imagine, embryonic stem cells. Or you can get them from adults. But not all stem cells are created equal. Stem cells that can take on any role are known as pluripotent, and their only limitation is they can't grow you a completely new body. You'll find pluripotent stem cells in embryos. Those that are still pretty versatile but can only take on a selection of roles are known as multipotent, and those are the ones that you'll find in an adult body. But work is being done to make adult stem cells pluripotent, so you won't need to get them from embryos, which is a bit of a touchy subject. Because stem cells can take on so many different roles, just like veteran actress Meryl Streep, our national treasure, researchers are using them in particular to help the body heal itself. A few stem cells can be extracted from a human and then grown in a lab, and once enough new cells have formed, they can be inserted into the patient again. Some recent trials have successfully treated congestive heart disease and regrown muscles in soldiers injured in explosions. But otherwise, right now, tissue engineering isn't playing a big role in treating various conditions. We've been able to create small arteries, skin grafts, cartilage, a trachea, and even a small supplemental bladder. But because the tech is so new, the cost is very high. And while we can create tissue for more complex organs like the heart or lungs, we're not at the point of being able to stitch them into you after you get hacked up by some insane plantation owner. But the tissues that are grown in a lab aren't just going to waste like the nice meal the baker's cooked you that you refused to eat. They're actually being used in medical research, reducing the number of helpless animals we need to experiment on. Now, if Google's Sergey Brin could just perfect his artificially grown hamburger and get it down to McDonald's prices, maybe we could just leave the poor cows alone already. And the people, too. Jeez, Baker family, just go to Trader Joe's, guys, come on. Hey, thanks for watching. If you're into the videos we make, please like and subscribe, and share this video with your friends too, who knows? Have any ideas for games or topics for us to cover? Leave it down in the comments below, and check out some of our other videos right here. And don't forget to keep on playing.